The Orion 1 model from OpenAI, better known as O1, has garnered a lot of attention since its release. Unlike other language models we've all seen, O1 has been trained to succeed at complex reasoning tasks. Here's the O1 preview page. As you can see, these models are described as being able to think before they answer, so they can produce a long chain of thought before responding. And the difference in performance from this is quite impressive. As the page states, the new model performs similar to PhD students on top benchmark tasks in physics, chemistry, and biology. And it scored 83% in a qualifying exam for the International Mathematics Olympiad. And its coding abilities reached the 89th percentile in a Code Forces competition. Naturally, since the architecture for this model has not been disclosed, there's a lot of curiosity out there about how it actually works. And so, of course, there are studies to try to understand that. Here's an example of one such paper. As you can see, four of the authors are members of OpenAI-o1, which is definitely not the same thing as OpenAI-o1. Here's the OpenAI-o1 GitHub page, which states that its mission is to match the capabilities of the OpenAI model using open source. Game on! And with that as context, let's take a closer look at this paper. Turns out, it answers some of the questions I think we all have, and also gives some interesting clues into how the O1 model works. For starters, the authors compared O1 against four well-known open source methods that are designed to achieve similar results. Those are self-refine, which uses iterative feedback to refine and improve initial outputs. Agent workflow, where an AI agent divides complex tasks into smaller ones and plans its execution based on that. Best of N, which is an approach where the language model is asked to generate multiple outputs, designated as N outputs, and then the most suitable response is selected. And stepwise best of N, which is similar to agent workflow in that it breaks down a request into subtasks, and also similar to best of N in that it generates N possible responses at each step. Basically, it's a hybrid approach. Now, let's compare the overall performance of each of those methods on these four problem sets. And we'll start with the lowest performing method and build up from there. First, self-refine, which got 5.6, which is pretty low, actually. That low score was due in large part to 0 points on Collie and on coding. Next in line, stepwise best of N, where N equals 4. That one also doesn't perform well on Collie and got 0 points on coding. What happens with this method is that on complex questions, it generates numerous intermediate steps and then loses track of the original question. Not good. Next up, best of N, where N equals 4. That's interesting and a bit counterintuitive. All things equal, best of N beats stepwise best of N, even though the stepwise aspect is extra effort that's theoretically there to improve performance. Sometimes simpler is better. Next up, best of N, where N equals 8, which gives another bump in performance. Actually, this bump is more meaningful than it might appear at first. For comparison purposes, here's how GPT-4o performs on these same benchmarks as a standalone model without the help of any of these methods. So, this is the first score we've seen that actually beats that baseline. Next is agent workflow, which, as you can see, is pretty significantly ahead of GPT-4o as a standalone model. And the reason agent workflow performs so well is that it has a series of domain-specific prompts which help to tighten up the reasoning process. And it's certainly possible that the O1 model is similar in design to that, but maybe with a more diverse set of response types. Anyway, this one is our performance baseline as we turn now to the O1 models themselves. And here they are. Preview at 34.3 and Mini at 35.8. Very impressive. Now, let's unwrap this further. Here's the reasoning page at platform.openai. You can see it says, the O1 models introduce reasoning tokens. The models use these tokens to think by breaking down their understanding of a prompt and considering multiple approaches to generating a response. So that way the model doesn't have to directly generate a final output in one go. Here's what some of those tokens look like. And these sub-steps include various strategies like scratchpad methods, where intermediate calculations are done, or tree-like structures, where multiple branches are explored in parallel, or error correction, where the model is able to backtrack and correct errors in previous steps prior to generating a final response. As we know, transformer language models have self-attention layers, which are there to enable language understanding. But for the O1 model, those layers were modified to support reasoning loops. In other words, the reasoning tokens are designed to bias the attention of the model to better succeed at tasks that require nuanced or multi-step reasoning. And those biases are generated by a loss function derived from reinforcement learning on difficult tasks. And since the O1 model generates intermediate outputs, we can get a pretty good insight into how it arrived at its final answer each time. And from looking at those outputs in a structured way, the authors of the paper identified 6 types of reasoning patterns. First, we have classic problem types like the knapsack problem. Imagine you have a knapsack with a fixed weight capacity of W. You have N items, each with a weight of WI, and each one has a value of VI. Maximize the value of the contents without exceeding W. Of course, this is a classic problem type with a classic solution approach. Another similar example is the shortest path problem. Apparently, if Model O1 identifies the request as belonging to one of these problem types, it uses the corresponding solution approach for that. And this situation is what the authors refer to as method reuse. The second pattern is systematic analysis, which is when the model is faced with a more unique problem and responds by evaluating the overall problem structure, including the constraints, and then selects a logical framework for solving that. The third is divide and conquer, which breaks down a complex problem into parts and designs the overall solution by solving each of those parts one by one. Next is self-refinement, which is where we can see in the outputs that the model sought to identify and correct issues or errors it found in its own reasoning process. Next is context identification, which refers to cases where the model first summarizes key aspects of the context drawn from various sources, and then bases its response on that summary. And finally, emphasizing constraints, which is where we can see in the outputs that the model is paying particularly close attention to the conditions that are needed for a valid answer. So, we have 6 reasoning patterns, and 4 problem sets. Let's finish off by mapping those, because doing that will give us a good insight into whether or not the O1 model is truly adapting its approach based on the type of problem it's facing. And the short answer is definitely yes. The use of reasoning patterns is not random at all. First, at a high level, we can see here that there are some patterns that are never used on certain kinds of problem sets. By the way, the percents in each column add to 100. So this shows the share of each of the 6 reasoning patterns that was applied to each problem type. Clearly not random. And here's the share of the reasoning methods per problem set overall. You can see, for example, that divide and conquer is the most used approach overall, but it's never used on Collie, which makes sense because tasks within the Collie dataset require generating a paragraph based on various constraints, as you can see illustrated here. Divide and conquer is pretty much irrelevant for doing that. And so it is for the others as well. The selection of reasoning methods is far from random, and in fact, the choices map in a logical way to the problems that they address. In short, the reason why the O1 model outperforms current methods is most likely a combination of tighter integration within the model itself, coupled with a more diverse set of reasoning methods as compared to agent workflow, for example. And it all adds up to a 39% improvement over state-of-the-art, which is very significant. And surely, this is just the beginning. Meanwhile, thanks for watching and see you next time.